though we could speak also in Dutch or / Afrikaans, because my guest for this talk is Hemel Basem.
Hemel Basem, yeah.
What betekent Hemel Basem?
Hemel Basem betekent bij een verschrikkelijke lang man.
Ja.
Ja, maar ik ben niet heel lang.
Nee.
Nee, maar ik ben lang in de binnenkant. I'm very tall on the inside. Yeah?
Oké, okay, good. Ja, helemaal goed.
En ik heb ook een bije lange, verschrikkelijke lang verhalen. Story.
Yeah. So, how many of you understand Afrikaans? Boys begrijp Afrikaans? No? Yeah, Afrikaans. Okay, good. We'll do it in Afrikaans if that's okay for you. No. You can speak Afrikaans if it goes too fast.
You don't understand Afrikaans.
Oh, yes, yeah. Mohammed Rabih from Egypt. You know, it's like, does understand Afrikaans?
You don't understand
Strange. It's a world language.
Yeah.
Okay, then we go switch to English.
Yep.
Hemel Basem, you are one of maybe the biggest world artist, rapper in Afrikaans in South Africa, and you chose two books as books of my life, book van mijn leven.
Yeah, yeah.
One of them is the Hendrik Witbooi papers. We come to that later.
Yeah, yeah.
And you chose the Bible.
Yeah,
the Bible. So, my question is, waarom de Bijbel?
Waarom de Bijbel?
Ja.
Niet uit, from a religious perspective.
Ja.
Not from a religious perspective. I must say that there's something about, there's this scripture that says, look at the rock from which you are cut. Yeah?
Mm.
And it's these type of beautiful metaphors that lingers within me as a human being. But it was also forced upon me. It's not something that I chose per se. It's something that chose me in a sense. Because I grew up in a community where that was the only door and the only window, as well as the only spiegel, the only mirror.
Really?
Yeah.
Can you describe to me your environment, where this took place?
Yes. I grew up in the Cape Flats. I was born in the Namaqualand, which is the northern Cape in South Africa. Very, very impoverished. We call it shacks, sinkhuise.
Yeah.
So I used to grow, I grew up in one of these shacks. And, you know, poverty as this thing that's almost like sinking sand.
Yeah.
Where you have to throw your hand out to something that's stable. And the only thing that seemed constant throughout the ages for our people was spiritual things, even the Bushmen. And in my time, it was the book which we know as the Bible, the Biblios.
Yeah.
And it became a very important part of my moral compass.
So you would go to church or... Your parents would read out of the book, and you would listen to the stories.
No, I grew up as a Roman Catholic. I was born as a Roman Catholic, yes. And it was unheard of then. The father of the house, he is staunch Roman Catholic, but he doesn't go to church.
Okay.
He doesn't even pray in words or anything. He just say, "Look here, my son. Let me tell you, when I eat, anything I can do is just, then I'm safe." Then I have hope. Then I have anything. For years, that was the case. But as a struggling teenager, I remember the day very clearly. And again, it's not from a religious perspective, but it is an actual account of my life. I was working very hard. I was a carpenter as a young man with my father. Very, very hard work.
Yeah.
After school, I used to work. And I had a back. I still have a lower back problem. Because of the, my father taught us, you don't bend with your knees when you hit. You have to stand straight and bend. Yeah. And like that, that was my life, yeah? And one time I was just aching with pain. And I was lying there. And some pastor came through on our yard. And I just heard his voice while I had just lingered and rested for a minute. And he said, it's good for a young man to bear the yoke in his youth. And I remembered because he spoke it in English, yeah. And it was a biblical quote.
Yeah.
And that is the first time I met a guy by the name of Pastor Terence Europa. And he really influenced my life in a very, very good way as a still man who, in our areas, obviously people come knock at the doors, they talk to you. That is the environment.
Yeah.
And he introduced me to a deeper level of biblical ideas.
So your literary development started there with these stories.
Yes, I am an artist, and most of the, I have to attribute it to the way the church functioned where I come from, because I had the opportunity to come to in front of the podium. I had to speak to people. You know, you shake at first. They teach you it's okay. You know, you had to be creative. You had to capture an audience. I've seen so many poor people. I've seen intellectual people come in and break the word and say, listen, you know, amen. A means this. You know, and it taught me critical thinking.
Mm.
Yeah. And as a hip-hopper especially, it was easy, it became easy to even toy with people because you need to read a crowd. That was very important thing for me at that time. And I learned it in the church here.
So let's go to the stories of the Bible.
Yep.
What were the stories that spoke to you, that aroused you?
Yeah,
the
main story that is a theme of my life,
it's a
narrative that you'll find in the Quran, you'll find it in Jewish scripture, a very important figure, and it is the Davidic narrative, David's narrative.
Mm.
The idea of a David and a Goliath, a giant, you know, and just some small kid trying this giant out. And the reason it resonates with me, and as when we continue with my next book as well, it's the same narrative. It's the same narrative in my life. And there's one thing that I read a book called The Wisdom Hunter one time in my life, and it told me to kind of, the book said, this character in the book said, I threw out a Bible, and I took a small little book with nothing in it, and then I started writing my own Bible. Things that I learned, you know, practical.
Yeah.
And at that specific venture, I kind of did that. And the one thing that I took from the actual existing Bible was what this one scripture where David looked around and he saw everybody is in angst and they worry.
We have this situation, the Philistines are coming to fight the tribe of David.
So you have Goliath sitting there and whatever.
Yeah.
And David comes to him, to the guys, and he's like, but why is this guy shouting against you guys? You are a mighty army. And then they all were afraid of the sounds of Goliath. But he says this one thing, and I like it, and it resonates, and it echoes in my life. He says, do not be disheartened by this uncircumcised Philistine. Your servant will go and fight him. And that is the audacity of a young man, of a boy, the beauty, the romance, the chaos that he found himself in, but the courage that he found in himself to actually just go and do that. And that is something that really resonates in my life. And in all the works that I've done, anybody in South Africa that knows me, the work that I've done, I'm not supposed to do what I did. I was in a radio in the radio industry. I never studied that. I'm on the television. I never studied that. I write. I didn't study any of this. Most of the stuff that I do with the universities and with other pundits, I never studied it. I'm not supposed to do it. But what I learned is that whatever irritates you, it points you to some sort of purpose. Whatever irritates you, because that was a voice that only irritated him. It didn't irritate the other people, you know? So I kind of resonate with that, and I liked it, yeah.
So we have this wonderful, eloquent Hamel Basem / David fighter in English, but you choose to speak in Afrikaans.
Yeah.
And one of your songs called God Praat Afrikaans.
Yes, God Speaks Afrikaans, yeah. The reason for God Praat Afrikaans is...
Can you recite that song for us a little
yeah,
bit?
Yeah, no, I can recite. Let me do the first bit. It just says, my hele concepts, a context, kom van a context. A con, dis my zo kom ek blom in die omtrek van jou context. Ja, want wie dan om klaar verbeel? Wie het die taal gesteel? Die ou wat die kraal beheer, of die man wat die skape teel? Sulke vraag, wel het hinne my nie. Het was een animal hier, maar in een manier is het Afrikaans as hy praat binnen my hier. So, what I'm saying is, in the context of being a con, because that is what, it's the idea of who stole whose language in South Africa. In Afrikaans it's like, nah, you guys are damaging the language with how you speak it, because it's either seen as a colloquialism or a dialect, where in my opinion, you can only call something a dialect or a colloquial a way of speaking or any of that type of definitions if it already included everybody's opinion about that language or assisted in the growth of the language. For us, it was standardized by a group of people, right? And again, it's not Mensa, it's the machine. It's not someone, it's the system.
You talk about the status of Afrikaans in South African society.
Yes, yeah. So the status, there's a standardized idea of Afrikaans, but it doesn't include a lot of the vocabulary of the people that speaks it the most according to statistics in South Africa. So for me, it's important to become a David in that sense, where this is a giant. It's not someone per se, you know, but you have to rise to meet it on its level. And that's why I'm here, Mobiism. You have to become bigger than what you are to kind of look at it, face it in the eyes.
So, you really had to fight for your own language.
Yes.
You had to become a kind of freedom fighter for the right to use the language you wanted to.
Yes.
To convey your message.
Yes, and that's why I write it like a context from my concept. So a con in your context. So what I'm saying is, I reflect a con in your context.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's the context that you see me in.
How were the reactions of the audience when you first came out with this bold statement?
At first, my publisher said, no, they don't like the name. You know, I should change the name. God speaks Afrikaans. Then I said, listen, today it's really an open interpretation. Yeah. But because this book is a true reflection of my opinion of where I was, I try to stay as true to the narrative as possible. Because I was a kid. Some of them, the imaginations or the things that the nostalgia that I have now, it doesn't include the finer details. But I'm still honest to how I saw it when I was young. So at first they were a bit scared, but the moment I put it out there, everybody said the impact of the book was in such a nature that people phoned me, the inboxes, especially, and they said that story that you're telling, it's my story
as well. It's this book. It's this book you wrote.
Yeah, this
is the book.
Yeah, so it's a people. It's been put on the shelves as an autobiography.
Yeah,
I'm not that old, but this is basically a memoir boasting as an autobiography.
Yeah,
it's not really an autobiography.
Can you read a little something to us?
Yeah, not a problem. Not a problem. I think there's a. It's not net gedichten, but this is the first time where what we call hip-hop rap in Afrikaans, we call it rhyme klets. Yeah? Rhyme klets. Because you first need to rhyme before you can klets. Right? And, but this is the first time where you will, for instance, see that in a book, we have put the lyrics down of an Afrikaans rapper. Now, Afrikaans rap is not like American idea of rap. We have to understand it. It's a culture on its own. When NWA was in South Africa a couple of years ago, Chuck D said that Afrikaans hip-hop and the Cape Town scene, for him, is the hub of the culture of international hip-hop. Because it's nothing about money.
Yeah.
It's all about skill. Nobody has amazing sound systems, whatever. It's the technicality of how you have to write with the scalpel. Wow. You know, you have to be surgical with your writing, in a sense,
Because otherwise, otherwise you cannot take the floor. Otherwise, you will be out.
No, definitely, man, definitely. So in this book is also some of the gedichten.
Yeah.
But obviously, it's the story of my life where I come from, all right? So I'm going to read you something. And it's about poverty in a sense. It's called Stump and Stuart. Now, you see Samp and Beans. It's a staple food in South Africa in a sense. But where I come from, we call it stump and stewart. But stump is also stump and stewart, right? Yeah. And this specific lady, because I highlight in every chapter, I highlight a simple person that proved immense in my life. And she's just a simple person. She can't even read. It's that ignorant Christian woman, you know, if you come and she says, no, you have to pray before you eat. And when you pray, she grabs anything to put it on her head, you know, like, oh, I have to cover my head. That type of people, you know. Very ignorant, but beautiful souls. Yeah. But I placed her as an icon. Her name is Auntie Lena. So I'll just read a small bit of it. It's in Afrikaans, obviously. And it goes like this. Auntie Lena was a kwaai auntie. Nie die kwaai waarvoor mens weghardloop nie. Daai kwaai wat respek afdwing. In die tyd toe ek vir Pat en Lena se seun ontmoet het, het ons dit nie breed gehad nie. Ons het so skuins oor kan mekaar gebly. Ek en Pat het boesemvriende geraak. Ons het omtrent alles saam gedoen in Conifers. Soos die naam sê, was dit baie bosserig daai tyd, omdat ons huise van die eerstes was. So ons het daar rond gehardloop, sandduine op en af in die bosse skuilingsgebou waarin ons gaan hang het. Armoede doen iets wat ek dink rykdom nie kan regkry nie. As mens mekaar in die trenches van sukkel ontmoet, met dieselfde doel voor oë, bou daar bloedbande wat lank aanhou. Ek was nog nooit super ryk nie, maar mense wat ek ken uit daai geleedere se vriendskappe klink en lyk vir my maar baie plastiek.
Ja. Wow. I understand 80%.
Oh, well, thank you.
Yeah. What is the status of Afrikaans now in South Africa?
Afrikaans is still the best in terms of commerce in the world, in South Africa there. So most businesses it's still the vehicle that's used in terms of sell and all of that. Sports is still very much the biggest sport in South Africa. At one point it was, what is these dances, but it's still rugby. And rugby is very much Afrikaans still. And, you know, so commerce is big. Arts, it's still big. It's still some of the biggest sellers is Afrikaans musos. Yet, it's about 10.5-11 million people that speaks Afrikaans. But out of that 11 million, the most that speaks Afrikaans is the so-called colored people. Yeah. It's my demographic, yeah.
Yeah. So, the Bible, David and Goliath. But you chose another book. You're the only author of the six that chose two specific books. And the other one is, you brought it with you, is the Hendrik Witbooi papers.
Yeah, the Hendrik Witbooi papers.
We were just talking about Afrikaans and hip-hop and music and you identify yourself with David. But I understand this. I understand why you choose Hendrik Witbooi papers of what you told, because Hendrik Witbooi was also kind of David. Mm. In Namibia, and he fought against the German colonization. Mm. And he wrote a diary of his struggle to get rid of the Germans, and that's the Hendrik Witbooi papers. Mm. Why did you choose this book of this freedom fighter?
This is, I'm a very proud Witbooi myself, and I'm a very proud Nama person from the Nama tribe in South Africa, which is part of the Khoi. And Hendrik Witbooi is the king of the Nama. His Nama name is Kaup Nanse Abemab. Yeah? So it's a lot of clicks there for you.
This is Kosa.
No, it's not Kosa.
Oh, it's not Kosa.
It's Nama.
Oh, Nama.
Nama. So the first
You speak Nama.
No, not at all.
Okay.
The first clicks in South Africa, the clicks that you find in the Kosa people's language came from the Bushmen, the Khoi people. So that is the first languages from Nama and Khoi, which is Kuku Gwap, yeah? Which is, it has a lot of clicks in it. I'm not very good with that. But his name, Gaub Nganse Abemap, it simply means the captain that disappears in the grass. Wow. He had the ability as a guerrilla fighter to almost be invisible when he fought. So he knew his terrain, And every time people tried to capture him, it was almost impossible. So he got this name that, oh, you think you're still fighting him, and then he disappears in the grass. So I chose him because he's my great-great-great-grandfather. And if you go to Namibia, you'll find him on the $50 note. In fact, this is how he looks on the... So I have a tattoo of him here. This is how he look on the $50 note. He's also on the $100 note.
Wait, let me see. This is your grandfather.
Great-great-grand.
And this is a character from The Lion King?
From Lion King. Yeah.
Okay. And and who's there?
This is Immortal Technique. Yeah, he's an American MC. A very important figure in our time in terms of hip-hop.
And why did you choose to... I'm not going to talk about Lion King.
Yeah.
I'm going to talk about your great-grandfather. Why did you choose to immortalize him on your body?
You will never find any book on Hendrik Witbooi in South Africa.
Oh.
That is just ridiculous.
So?
So, the problem that I have as a human being living in South Africa is that our history is, you struggle to find, like I started with saying, you need to know the rock from which you are cut, right? We can't identify this rock. So we don't have something to press against when we need to go forward.
Who
right?
told you about Hendrik? Did your father tell you, your mother?
My father and my grandfather. Yeah. I was not interested in this history in the beginning. But when my grandfather died, he was a drunkard. Thomas Witbooi. He's a no-name, so you don't even have to go and search him. He's really a no-name.
Yeah.
He died not because he was a drunkard. He was 80-odd years old. But he died because a fishbone got stuck in his throat and... So, but up until his last day, he was still drunk. But he's one of those guys that never spoke to you, but only when he's drunk, he speaks to you. Then he took out his wallet and he'll take out the notes and say, you guys are royalty, you shouldn't, blah, 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 blah. But you never paid attention to him, you know? Because our people, they were too proud to share this information because they have nothing to show of this. So at his grave, when we were putting my grandfather in his grave, what came from that grave was the drive to understand this man. Yeah? And that, I think, is what fuels me at the moment. I am apolitical, so there's a lot of politics in terms of tribalism, etc. So I'm apolitical with regards to that, but I always want to capture the spirit of Hendrik Witbooi.
But why is this history about Namibian self-consciousness, freedom fighter? He fought against the Germans in what's called the Namibian genocide?
The Herero genocide, according to history, and a lot of science will point to this, is the first genocide that you'll find in history.
Why is this not known in South African schools? Why is this not part of the narrative?
That is the problem that we're sitting with, you know. Currently in South Africa, there is different tribes that is in charge. Yeah. So it's very much between Zulu and Xhosa.
Yeah.
If you look at our constitution, they are looking currently at the constitution in South Africa and trying to amend the bill. And in our constitution, it reads as follows. A black tribal leader, shall own people and land. Then second, it says, a brown tribal leader shall only have people.
This is in
the constitution. So what happens is the black tribal leaders, they get paid millions per year, you know, from the funds of the but a brown, they are all paupers. They are all.
So amending history has big consequences for the constitution.
Yes.
So but it's taboo. It's almost a taboo subject.
Yes. No. But they are fighting it now.
Okay.
Our current president, Cyril Ramaphosa, is really looking into this at this very point. Okay. So there's, since November, there was some Khoi people and Sun people that actually marched to the union buildings. And as I speak, I think they're still at the union buildings, camping outside the union buildings talking about it.
Do you support this movement?
I don't necessarily support. I don't recognize because obviously with amending the bills, you get a lot of new kings that just somewhere pop out all over the place. So I don't recognize this guy as a king, but I recognize his guts and I recognize his vision, you know? I am as a person, I'm a bridge builder. Yeah. And I don't care what a person's background is in terms of sex, race, whatever, age. But if you have the same vision, Then I'm in your camp. Yeah.
Is Hendrik Witboy in your hip hop, in your rap, in your text? Can you recite something?
Yeah, I can recite something from you for you from Hendrik Witboy. It's very small, but at the end, because I'm working on a whole project on Hendrik Witboy, and this comes from a text, the last chapter in the book that says "Ons kook nie sag nie." We don't cook soft. That is a saying in the Makwaland for the people on that side. If you want to fight somebody and they start fighting each other, they say, "But I don't cook soft, you know. Ek kook nie sag nie." And as a Namakwaland, Namakwa person, it's a very important saying. Mm. So it goes like this. It says, "Ek skal het met die tribal flair. Kal het vrou, why life ain't fair. En al was sy 'n beach, sukkel ek om by te sê. Julle dictionaries, I don't care. Kalit maak van 'n hallo en 'n hi away. Kalit, soos dames wat 'n crush het op jou, vat hy kroeshare vir 'n wash en 'n blow. Kids, soos peanut butter en brood, kids met wafferse drome, maar skiems kap hulle dood. Die jagter in my, wat so sit, hy moet opstaan. Slavernij, rus in 'n klokkaart. Vra vir my, 'n vis vrot van die kop af. En ons leadership, wat evil is, moet eindelijk toch repent het. Ek skrievelrig met vier binne, kaptein is nog 'n template. Witboy moet hands down geprys word, cemented. En gee vir my 'n Nelson, dan reis ek jou 'n Hendrik.
Mm. Nice. Ja. Yeah. Mm. I mean, the general opinion sees hip hop as very, it's about money, materialism. It's also creating an atmosphere of an anonymity. So, us against them, you know. You just said, "I'm a bridge builder." How does hip hop come in there? What does it do for you as a bridge builder, hip hop?
Yeah, kids don't look at lawyers. Kids don't want to really become lawyers anymore, nurses, policemen, and all of that. They find the idea of success not in finishing your school, finishing tertiary education.
Yeah.
They find it in the icons they see on TV and hear on radio and read about, the flashy people. And most of them are actors, radio singers, vocalists, all of that. And a lot of them, according to statistics right all over the world, is hip-hoppers. Yeah. Just before I got here, I found a new statistic that showed that in all the genres, the people who use the most words as the better vocabulary is hip-hoppers in the world, okay? And I go to schools, I work there because they find some sort of, they can relate to me. And there was a guy that said, "You can't redeem somebody if you can't relate to them."
Hmm.
And for me, that is so, so important, to relate to people. And in Cape Town, South Africa, and especially all the demographics right around South Africa, if you go there and you look like a normal guy, but you start rapping, it's like, "Yo, man, I want to do that," you know? But most of the places where I go to, they rap in English,
yeah.
Right? Because the only thing they hear on TV and radio is English. So what I've seen, the problem that we find is they are losing their tongue, yeah, which is Afrikaans. And the moment you lose your tongue, you're not confident to share your story. Mm. So we are losing all the Khoi people's story because they don't share it in English. The moment they sing, rap, or portray anything on TV in English, it's all Americanized. It's not really English, you know? So every time I finish at a school, kids always come up to me and say, "You know what? I did this in English, but I'm going to do it in Afrikaans now, man. You inspired me in that way." And that's why I do it in Afrikaans, yeah.
Hemel Basem, thank you very much for this inspiring talk.
No, thank
you. And I would say, preach on, brother.
No, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.